This video should have been 1 hour long. Let's see how short I can make it. DC-105, the 80-200 zoom, Nikon, right? 105 2.5 AIS or AI. And this one, I don't remember. It was another 105, I have no idea, or 100, I don't remember which one it was, back in April 2017. Sharpness, rendering, all the same, and I took special care to frame them exactly the same. One would notice that the car here on this, on the 105 2.5, is a little darker, and people will say, oh, that better color saturation. Yeah, you know what, I see the bluish though all over the place. I see a bluish cast, and I took more images, and it confirmed my finding, and it also confirmed things that expert reviewers have said casually when reviewing this lens or other similar lenses of that line, the bluish cast over the image. And when I reviewed the per channel histogram on each image, I found that the blue was under illuminated, which gave it the impression of more saturation. Remember, more saturation, remember from the controls, means towards black, towards zero. More luminance means towards 255, towards white. And that would give it the blue cast all over the image. That's also a result that I had with the Nikon 85 1.4D, the old one. A bluish cast over the image that was a pain in the ass to remove. So now contrarians, one or two contrarians will say otherwise, because if they say that 2.2 equals 5, they're going to generate more hits and fill up the church with people who suspect that the entire world around them is fake, and that only the new prophet knows the truth, because the world is fake. On the right side, you were always going to be seeing the 105, 105 1.4 Nikon. Here on the left side, we have the 85 1.4G, and this is aperture 1.4, wide open. So now we have the bokeh in the background is obliterated in the 85. There is a purple fringing, which is almost absent here. There's a little bit. The catch light on the eye is purple. Here it is a little purple, more to the white. Color purity, purple fringing here, as you can see on the white. The white here is much more clean on the 105. Still though, for the 85 1.4G, this is very respectable performance given the conditions of the test. Let me show you the conditions. So this is how the test environment looked in the human eye. The mannequin looked almost black, and I was focusing here on this eye wider, and the background was obliterated by the sun. Why did I choose this setting? Well, because people go out with their families in the park, and they put the family in the shade, and they want to take a picture, and the background is obliterated, and this is an extreme case of it. A very extreme case, because the rest of the house was not lit. It was completely dark. So this is the extreme case of, let's say, a park scene where you have a very dark shadow and the background is obliterated, and the lens is asked to find focus and expose correctly. At 1.8, we have a third contestant entered the game, the Nikon 1.8G, 85 1.8G. In the middle is the 1.4G, and here is the 105. So at 1.8G, this time it decided to focus accurately versus the previous test, we see a remarkable performance of the little Nikon. Remarkable. Look at the sharpness at 1.8, which is its most wide aperture. Well, we have strong purple fringing and stuff, but so does the 1.4G. And we have more fringing here, greenish. The bokeh is obliterated in both the G lenses, and it's there in the 104. Color, purity, and everything. We have a little bit of purplish here. This is now has turned white, and this is the most pure white on the right. But these two, this is a little out of focus, so I would consider this to be a good value too. At f2.2, the bokeh is still obliterated in the 2G lenses. It's more present in the 105, and all of a sudden now chromatic aberration started to creep in the 1.8G lens, and this happens sometimes. If you go to the website opticallimits.com, you will find that some lenses, I don't know if they tested this lens to find the same thing, but it depends on the shooting conditions too, and some lenses we have higher aberrations at 4.5 than they have at 2.2. It's weird really, but it happens. I don't know if that was the case here. So you see we have more fringing here. See the hair, they appear more clean here because of less fringing. And here they appear very clean on the 105. Now as far as micro contrast, as you can see, micro contrast is stronger. Let's put the same dimensions, stronger on the 105 and the 1.4G. The 1.4G actually has an advantage here, probably because of better focusing too. You can never tell if the conditions are very difficult. But this is a 2.2 and it's, is it 2.2? F2.2, a very respectable performance of all three of them. And this fringing here can be very easily eliminated because it's minor really. At 2.8, the background still is obliterated in the older lenses. Micro contrast improved throughout. Some purple fringes started to creep in the 1.4G. Not very evident on the hair though. The hair on the 1.4, the 105 lens appears more free of chromatic errors now and other issues that normally obliterate it, and the white appears still the cleanest of the three lenses. Now as far as color is concerned, because I know how it looks in reality, I would give this to the 1.8G. That was a surprise, huh? In this specific aperture, the 1.8G has the more accurate color, followed by the 105 and the 1.4G, the last. At f4, some of the bokeh, just a tiny bit, may start to appear in the background, but it's still obliterated in the other two lenses. The 105 now has the better bokeh by far, even if it's blown out. Sharpness-wise, you have to really pixel peep to see actually that this takes like 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10, 10 out of 10, right? Both sharpness and micro contrast. See, this is what we mean by micro contrast. Now it's too much here. As far as color accuracy, now it's time to give it to the 105 at this aperture. The second is the 1.8, and the third one is the 1.4G. A lens which tends to add a little bit of warmth to the image, which can be very desirable in portraits, right? Generally speaking, as far as color, clarity, and purity, I will give this to the 105, but the second position, the two others are equivalent, basically. But look at these two here. You see, this is a little cooler. This is a little warmer. You see that? I don't know if you can see that on your screens. I don't know what YouTube is going to do with this video when I upload it. And finally, we'll take the winner, which is the 105 1.4. And at aperture of 2.2, we will compare it with the Zeiss Zonar apochromatic lens at 2.2. Observe the bokeh, the Nikon on the left, the Zeiss Zonar on the right. Big difference, huh? At f2.2. Observe these lines here in the bokeh. See these lines here? Now let's go to the hair. observe the hair on the Nikon 105 and look at the Zeiss on the right. It's a different world, right? Let's check now. The Zeiss is manual focus. Look at the sharpness and micro contrast. What am I telling you guys about apochromatic lenses so long? Look at the color purity. Look at the white. I don't know how well it shows on your screens. Of course, this test could be like while you compare it, because the Zeiss is an entire class on its own. Look at the hair here. That's all at 2.2. And the Zeiss is a longer lens. It's a 135. So normally, this should have been more blurred. Normally, right? Because a 135 has a shallower depth of field than the 105. Finally, I did some more focus tests. Again, the environment was dark, and I was walking around with the lenses up and down the corridor, back and forth, and just shooting handheld. The test was to see, now this for example, you see this is slightly missed. The focus here is slightly missed. The model was dark, as I showed you. This is the flash. That's flashing on the face. The flash is remotely controlled. Okay, so this, for example, is more in focus. Actually, this is excellent. Which one is this? This is the 105, yeah. The 105 got more images in focus than the other two, but it was not like a guarantee or anything. And I would say, if I took 10 images, let's say, with each lens, and the model was dark and I was walking back and forth and focusing on the spot and taking the picture without waiting or hesitating, the 105 took like 7 out of 10 in focus. The other two took about half of them in focus, 5 out of 10, which means you gotta take pictures anyway. And you know, because usually YouTubers upload videos and say, oh, look at the focus that I nailed, and they don't show the rest of the roll. That's why they don't show, or the conditions were excellent. If the conditions are excellent, all of these three lenses will focus accurately 90 or 100% of the time. But take more than one, just in case. Dimensional rendering, this is the 85 1.4. This is the 105, and this is what I wanted to focus on. Because people say, not people, one or two people only, that the lens renders flat. I don't see anything flat here. The white light fixture pops out of the picture just fine. This is at f1.8. The bokeh kind of like appears gradually. So with this lens, you're not going to have the abrupt cut off, the slice of the Zeiss Otus, which is unpredictable in most cases, right? The 105, just by taking this image, I noticed that number one, no aberrations, no purple fringing. Remember the picture from the previous video of this specific light fixture that was packed with aberrations from the 85? Not the case here, even at 1.8. And the results are predictable, which means the bokeh is nice and pleasant, but it's not unpredictable, like the Zeiss Otus. So you know the results that you're going to get, which means this is a lens for professionals. Lenses for professionals have predictable results. They don't have this magic bokeh all over the place appearing out of, you know, because you took one step forward or one step backwards and the whole scene changed and all that. The Zeiss Otus is more like an artistic and cinematic lens. This is more like a professional photography lens. Would I buy it? Very hesitantly. I'll probably not buy it because it's kind of heavy. Well, it's not that heavy, but to carry it around, only 105, and it's not stabilized. So I'm very hesitant about that. I mean, I give $2,000 for a portrait lens without stabilization. The ghost of my father will visit me at night if I do that, and with not good intentions. At any rate, This is with the 85 1.8G, the cheap one. If you notice here, chromatic aberrations, they will appear, right? This is normally black. It's not supposed to be brown purple. Look at how strong they are in areas of reflection. You see that? So you probably say, oh my god, this lens is crap. It renders everything purple. See, let's see how easy you can fix that. So we open the Adobe camera raw and we go to the area where we want to fix, and it has this tremendous purple fringing and everything, right? You see that? So we go to the lens module and we enable the profile corrections, but I don't really want to enable the distortion. And I go here in the purple and I start sliding it until I see the purple disappear. But not more than that, because this correction affects the entire image. And I can see here that number 7, it disappeared. Number 6, it is a trace of it there, but it's acceptable. So I will leave it number 6. You see now it's corrected. Let's put it number 7. And now I'm going to hit this and I'm going to check out if the image was destroyed, and it wasn't. As a matter of fact, if you notice, the contrast was improved. Notice the contrast of the shadow versus the painting here and here. The right image, which is the after image, now looks improved. As a matter of fact, everything looks improved, even in the face. Well, the face is in the bokeh area, but I'm just saying. You know, everything, and the contrast here and the little flower things. These are plastic flowers, by the way. Everything was improved. And then you can continue with the rest of corrections. That's because of the good plasticity of the Nikon files, as I said in the past. You can subject them to an enormous amount of corrections and they still hold up. My conclusion is that all three lenses stand just fine, with the 85 1.8G being a bargain. I mean, excellent bargain, excellent bargain. Because the 1.8G, you correct a little the chromatic aberrations if you have them in extreme situations, and it renders like a professional lens. Now, as far as the 105 1.4, the plus is that it saves time in correcting chromatic aberrations, so the color is going to be more pure, better density and everything. It has excellent micro contrast, it's sharp, excellent dimensional rendering, focuses accurately, but it makes the send front heavy. It's not a long lens, it's a short, stubby lens. But it's a little heavy, and it makes the set front heavy, which will result in tired wrists and forearms. It should have stabilization for its price. I gotta say that. For its price, it should have stabilization, because it's an expensive lens. Now, with stabilization, it would have been even bigger, right? So that's a price to pay, I guess, but you gotta shoot this lens at a speed of at least 1/300th of a second and up, because it's a very sharp lens, and you're gonna see. I mean, if you shoot it at the at 105 or 150 or 200th of a second, you may see a little shaking there. Thanks a lot, bye.